Thanks for coming out. My name's Tim McDonald, and you're hearing fiddle music as it would have been in the late 18th century. Out of the tunes you'll hear are from that period. This instrument itself is from that period, and this would have been heard in Edinburgh and in Aberdeen, and then also in the Canadies. So what you just heard was a set of tunes by a man named William Marshall, who was born in 1747. And up next is a set by one of his colleagues, Robert McIntosh, my personal favorite, and he was born in 1745. Song, and it was written after the Scottish Rebellion in 1745. The Scots had a very decisive victory at the Battle of Preston Pans, where the English general John Cope was sort of wandering around in the bog with his men at 4 o'clock in the morning, which is really a big mistake. And suddenly he found himself surrounded on three sides by Highlanders who had no shirt and very long spears. And they did a Highland charge on his troops, who were completely confused, and it was something like many hundreds of English casualties and like three Scottish casualties. So somebody wrote a song called "Hey Johnny Cope, Are You Walking Yet? Are Your Drums Even Beaten Yet?" About how bad this defeat was. So you can really hear the arrogance in it. And then I'll play some stuff after it that's less fun. The last song is about another favorite Scottish hobby. One is beating the English, and the other is hanging out with the women.
Is that drinking?
That's the third one.
Aye. Thank you.
So since I have a captive audience, I'm going to change it up and play a slow tune. This is from a little earlier. It's first published in about the 30s, maybe the 40s. And it's called Through the Wood Laddie. And I'll try to keep it PG-13, but the lyrics are something to the effect of, come through the wood laddie so that you can ravage me. So it was very popular in the 18th century to choose a popular tune and then show how great you were by playing variations on the tune. And the variations either showed off how good you were as a player, because they were hard, or how good you were as a composer, because you made them up on the spot. And in fact, there's an account of a fairy fiddler, that is, a fiddler who played on a ferry as it went across a river or across an inlet. And he played this very tune, and he made up variations for the length of the ferry ride, which was over an hour. So I won't be quite that historically authentic today, but I'll give you a taste of the variations. And some already exist and some are original. Okay. I don't know what I'll do yet, because I'll make it up. And I play this on the arm, because it's a legitimate technique, playing up here, playing up here. This just changes the relationship between gravity and the bow, and it makes it a little bit punchier, a little bit stronger. Thank you. Authentic to the fiddler to compose his own music, and then some standard ones. The last one is hilarious to me because it's called Johnny's Friends Are Never Pleased, and if you're pleased at the end of the tune, there's something wrong with you. The goal is to be displeasing. You'll see what I mean. Guys, hear me in back? Excellent. Thank you. So many of you know that several times a year I fiddle for what's known as the Oxbow Tavern, which is a tavern that does late 18th century, early 19th century everything, food, drinks, cookingware, entertainment, etc., and entertainment, and I'm the fiddler there. So up next is a set of tunes that's a favorite among several Oxbowers. So far has been on the lower class end of the scale and on the later in the 18th century end of the scale. But Scotland was relatively unique in that the music and the dance scene cut across class boundaries. So up next I'll play a minuet and then some other tunes. And a minuet we associate with court dancing, except in fact it was popular up and down the social ladder in Scotland. So you can hear sort of maybe a more refined sound, and then I'll go into another set of realms that's sort of back to the normal. So the summary is, this is what we call a Baroque bow. Some people call it a sonata bow or a pikehead bow. But this was popular from the late 17th century up until around the end of the 18th century. And in contrast to a modern bow, which I don't have right here, but you've seen Bantam bows before, it's about 33% lighter. It has this sort of pointy tip instead of the traditional hatchet head. It's curved outwards instead of curved inwards. It has less hair on it. And all of these changes, it's not an inferior bow per se. It just focuses on different things. So what it focuses on is shaping the nose. So when I just draw the bow across the strings, you'll hear it sort of tapers, like it sort of swells and tapers. It's a very nice effect. Like you hear it has that bite and then it. And then if you play something a bit longer. A very intimate sound, right? This other bow that I'm using. This is known as a transitional bow. Hopefully this is of general interest. This is a transitional bow. It's heavier, it's longer. You can see the stick and the hair are parallel. The tip is a different shape. And all of this, you lose a bit of the the finesse of the sound, but it projects a bit more. And it bounces differently, so this is ideal for Mozart. Etc. I've been switching between them, because especially in this space, the extra volume for this one is sort of a nice thing. But when I play something like a minuet, I really want the control that the other bow gives me. And both are appropriate for the 1770s through 1800. Anyway, ask a simple question, get a lecture, right?
That's wonderful. Thank you.
It is a history festival. Anyway, here's the minuet and then a few reels. Thank you. So I've talked a bit about dance music, you know, sort of more classical oriented music. Another major genre for musicians of the time period was the lament. So I'll play a tune by one of the greatest fiddlers ever, whose name is Neil Gow. And he played basically exclusively with his brother, who was a cellist. The standard band in the 18th century was fiddle and cello, or as you say, re-fiddle and bra-fiddle, you know, two sides of the same instrument. Anyway, Donald died, as people do, and this sent Neil into this great big depression, and the story is that he refused to play in public for about 5 years, because he was just like, my brother died and my cellist died, and it's not worth paying for people, and if I don't have my cellist there, you know, he was my very favorite accompanist, you know, there's no point. And there's an inscription in the book that says, it was only after great solicitation by respected patrons that Neil could be prevailed upon to play again. And the rumor is that he played this tune, lamenting the death of his brother, as the very first thing. So this is Neil Gow's lamentation over the death of his brother, Donald. Change of pace. Some of you know that my primary impression and area of interest is of this sort of Scottish-American 1770s fiddler. But I also like to portray George Gibson, who was a member of the Lewis and Clark expedition and was almost certainly Scotch-Irish, though we don't know this for sure, and fiddled when he was on the trail with the Corps of Discovery in 1803. So now that you've heard sort of this 70s style in your head for 40 minutes, I'm gonna play my best guess at what George Gibson would have sounded like, so you can sort of hear like the next generation of American fiddling. And this is a tune that we know he played on the trail, which is kind of cool to me. Thank you. So a very important part of Scottish history and American history is that during the rebellion of 1745, Scotland not only lost, they lost badly. Britain wanted to form an empire, and they weren't content to just let the Scots ferment up north. They started a very systematic genocide, and they brutally, brutally evicted the Scots from the Highlands. They slaughtered many of them. They burned down their houses, they burned down their fields, they killed their sheep, they did everything they could to eliminate the sense of Highland identity. And they also passed a series of acts. Some call them the Prescription Acts, some call them the Intolerable Acts, at the end of the 40s, which outlawed the wearing of the kilt, the playing of the bagpipe, the speaking of the Gaelic language, etc., 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 because they were trying to commit this cultural genocide. And so many Scots fled to America, so there was this huge uprising in Scots in America at that time, and others had to sort of make do with what they could. So with bagpipes being outlawed, the fiddle really rose to prominence as the national instrument of Scotland, which is a place it held for about a century before the bagpipes took over again. And it was popular among fiddlers to play bagpipe music on the fiddle and try to imitate the pipes. And we call this pibrach, which is literally a Gaelic word that means piping. What are you playing? Oh, I'm playing piping music. That's all that pibrach means. And then that word has also evolved in meaning. So up next is a set of pibrach, but it's dance pibrach. And pay attention to how it's trying to imitate the sound of the bagpipes with the ornaments and with the droning and whatnot. Listen for that. And the first tune is a march. And bagpipes are very much in demand for marches because bagpipes are the instrument to transport armies from point A to point B. Strike up the pipes, they can be heard for miles, everyone marches and stuff, that's great. Fiddle marches weren't so popular because look at how hard it is to hear me 10 yards that way, you know. I couldn't get the 40 of you going in step, you know, much less an army. Form rank. By the steps. Thank you. So I played two more sets, and for a bit of contrast, I'll play one more slow tune. I'll keep up the Scottish history theme. Some of you may know that the Scots attempted to colonize Panama, but the reason there's no Scottish colony in Panama right now is because they collected 1/3 of the circulating capital in Scotland. 1/3 of Scotland's money, and outfitted 5 ships and several hundred settlers, and in the 1690s, sailed down to Panama. Everything that could go wrong went wrong. They had disease, they had starvation, they had trouble with the Indians, they had trouble with the Spanish, they had diplomatic trouble because they didn't actually own the land that they settled on. They had mutiny where the civilians and the military had disagreements about things and set up 2 rival camps. When you set up a rival camp with the military, that doesn't go well. And so eventually the resupply ship, I think, got lost or something, so the resupply situation was not great. Anyway, they decided to pack it home, and of the 5 ships that arrived in Panama, they had enough people to send 2 back. One was called the Caledonia, and one was called the Unicorn. The Unicorn is the national animal of Scotland, because we're cool. Anyway, so they sailed up the American coast, and they get as far as Perth Amboy in New Jersey. And then they realized that everyone was so sick and dying so quickly that they would run out of crew for 2 ships halfway across the Atlantic and be in trouble. So they had to decide to combine the 2 ships worth of crew onto 1 ship, the Caledonia, and they just abandoned the Unicorn on the shores of New Jersey. So this is a tune that I composed in a period style called Farewell to the Unicorn. And really, it's not just Farewell to the Unicorn, it's farewell to Scotland's dreams of colonization and empire and independence and whatnot, because 10 years later, the Act of Union was passed. So, Farewell to the Unicorn. Thank you. thanks so much for coming. I've had a lot of fun playing for you. Hope you enjoyed it. Thank you. I'm a full-time professional musician of this type of historic music, which was a crazy career choice. So if you have the means to feed the hat, it would be appreciated. And if not, no worries. But I'll play a nice variety set of tunes to send you off.